you, brothers and sisters. Again, as we continue with the same topic, the traits of the da'iyah. Last time we mentioned communication skills, and in that regard, especially for those who live in the West, I really urge them to learn the language of their countries, whether they are, I'm saying, like, most likely if you are an immigrant, you can always work on learning a new language. And trust me, learning this new language in itself with your good intention is considered to be a ibadah. It's a worship, because you are learning this with the intention of giving them da'wah. And work on, work on speaking more clearly, especially with English, subhanAllah. It's really, it's amazing to find that now with the influence of Hollywood and the US and the West, you find that even our youth, even our Muslim youth everywhere, everybody speaks English in the world, Muslims and non-Muslims, especially the youth generation, they are forced to speak English because, again, of globalization and the connections that now people have all over the internet. So work on that, inshallah. Work on your language so that you'll be able to give da'wah. You can even give da'wah over the internet. I cannot tell you, we've had so many people accept Islam through just the internet. And you could be sitting from the comfort of your own home in any Muslim country and give shahadas and give da'wah to people and really witness shahadas. In the West, I know a lot of people that have done that. And alhamdulillah, we help them as well to do that as well, in mercy for mankind. So what I was saying here, that the characteristic of a da'iyah, the more you perfect your characteristics, inshallah, the better of results, inshallah, you'll be able to obtain. Next one, inshallah, will be a very good characteristic. It's very external, but it's so, again, so needed, so essential. It is a good appearance. We find that the da'i ilallah should have good hygiene, good appearance. He should smell good, look clean. You'll find the Messenger of Allah SWT said, "Inna Allah nadhifu yuhibbu nadhafa," that Allah is clean and he loves cleanliness, and he says, as we also know that the Messenger of Allah SWT himself, always smelled musk. He smelled so good. He used to use that fragrance, which was very common at his time in Arabia, which is musk. He always smelled good. And when he was described as a very smiley person. He had really white clothes at all times. He looked so clean, and he had such a beautiful smile, beautiful teeth, because he used frequently the miswak. He used to brush his teeth so frequently, and his mouth always smelled good. And he was just such a pleasant character, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's so sad to find now, traveling throughout the world, you go to the Muslim countries, and you find people not paying attention to their hygiene, unfortunately. And then you go to the West, and people are so hygienic and so clean, and making sure that the clothes are clean, they have white smiles, they are, smelling good, and so on and so forth. As you know, while we Muslims, subhanAllah, we Muslims, and when you find the history of Spain, for example, I remember as a child, I was so interested in reading the Islamic history, and I read about Muslims in Andalusia, or old Spain, and how after the Inquisition started happening, after Queen Isabella took over Spain from the Muslims, and then the Muslims at a later stage were converted by force to be Catholics. They still, the government still sent people to make sure that these people who converted basically left Islam and became Catholic, they are still the Catholic. They didn't really fake their conversion. So one of the things, and again it's mentioned in the books, the way how they used to suspect that a person is a Muslim or not, if he takes a lot of showers. SubhanAllah, if he is paying attention to his hygiene, then you suspect he's a Muslim. That says a lot in itself. So good appearance, yes, we're speaking about it's external, but it's so important, because most people are superficial Anyway, I'm speaking of somebody doesn't have God in his life, somebody doesn't have Allah in his life. He's pretty much, or not saying everybody, but you find that good portion of them will be superficial and would look, judge you, you know, externally, you know, from the way how you look and the way how you dress and everything. This is why, as a Muslim, especially living in the West, should really look good. And I'm not saying dress anything that is haram or forbidden, as long as you are wearing a halal, you know, proper garment, then inshallah you are fine. But do not wear, you know, or you know, do not wear old smelly clothes and then or look dirty or have a yellow smile or not smell good and then expect people to understand, because unfortunately, you know, just people, this is the way how we are these days. We judge people externally. So good appearance is a must. Another characteristic that I'd like to mention, and is so related to the word of da'wah. We've been speaking about da'wah from the very beginning. Da'wah, da'wah, da'wah. And da'wah, again, going back to the very first stage or the very first episode, we mentioned that da'wah, it's an Arabic word that means invitation to invite mankind to Islam. And even that, using the word da'wah in itself, is it tells you so much, because an Arab, when he would like to honor a person and send him and basically invite him to their home or their wedding or to an important event, they send him something called da'wah, which means an invitation. So it carries lots of meanings. It's invitation with respect, with honor, with love. I mean, it just, it's such a profound term. So now the word da'wah, if you think about it, da'wah, you have da'wah, the Arabic word, and du'a. How is da'wah related to du'a? It is exactly the action of the prophets and the messengers. They used to always call their people. They would call them all the time to Islam. They would invite them to follow you know, Islam and to submit themselves and their will and worship their Lord, the all merciful, the all compassionate, their creator, their provider, the one who created them from nothing and blessed them with endless blessings and bounties. Brothers and sisters, da'wah is related to du'a. Those prophets and messengers, they would give da'wah to their people, but at the same time, they will always pray for them. And as I mentioned earlier, if you remember, رَبِّ هِدِي قَوْمِ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. The Prophet ﷺ, at all times, he prayed for his people, even during the worst times, when they hurt him the most. He said, oh Allah, please guide my people. Guide my people. He made dua for them. He supplicated and he prayed to Allah and he told him, guide them. So do not give up on them. You know, it's astonishing to find that some Muslims, because of, again, that conflict, that almost like clash of civilization that a lot of people have incited from both sides, you'll find that a lot of Muslims, they almost like feel good that those non-Muslims are non-Muslims because they have hurt them so much, whether abused them verbally or physically, and they would say, yes, they deserve to be disbelievers. No, it does not work like that, my dear brother. My dear sister, it does not work like this. Really, pray for those people. Pray for them. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide them. Do your very best. Really, do not give up on them. Pray. Da'wah and du'a. Give da'wah during the day and pray during the night. Beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cry to Him. Ask Him to guide those people, because wallahi, they need it. And if He does, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides those people through you or your prayers, it's the greatest treasure you can hunt. لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. For Allah to guide through you one person, one individual, one man or woman, shall be better for you than the whole world and what it contains. What a great treasure. So, brothers and sisters, talking about da'wah, it brings us to a very needed quality, which is confidence. When you give da'wah, you should be confident. You should really, here's a term that the scholars do use which is yaqeen, to have certitude, certainty about your own faith. Because if you, if your faith is shaky, and you have lots of questions that need to be answered regarding your own faith, you should get them answered first. You should work on developing your own iman to attain that certitude and that peace in your heart first regarding your faith. Because you can't just, as a Muslim, believe blindly. You know, you gotta have that yaqeen, which is based on so many things. So you can't just say, I'm a Muslim because my parents are. You cannot say, I'm a Muslim because, you know, this and this, or because, you know, why are you a Muslim? Because Islam is the truth. Well, I should ask you, why do you think Islam is the truth? You should work on that to make sure that you have that yaqeen in your heart. Of course, it is the truth, but then you should understand why it is the truth, and you should have that conviction, your own conviction first, of your own faith. Because guess what? Once you start giving da'wah, you'll be opening your chest, it will be wide open, and you're going to receive lots of hits, lots of bullets from, you know, allegations about the authenticity of Islam and Quran, and just attacks on the Prophet's character, attacks on the Sahaba's character, attacks on the jihad movement, and so on and so forth. There's so many things that Orientalists have used from such a long time ago, from centuries and centuries back. You have so many writings. Those people, they dedicated their lives, they dedicated their money, their all their resources to attack Islam. And it all started from the time of the Crusades, of course, long, long time ago. So you as a Muslim should really work hard on being confident and attain that certainty or yaqeen, certitude in your heart about your faith. Otherwise, you may hurt yourself during the process, and they'll give you an example, inshallah, next time in that regard. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of you and bless us, inshallah, and help us learn the matters of our religion, and help us, inshallah, stay strong upon the path of Allah until our very last day on this earth. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.